And so when we're doing a pick line, the right or left arm, this doesn't really matter. I generally prefer the left arm, but a lot of people prefer the right arm. This is the position that we normally use. I personally teach, and always when I'm doing this, is sit down, so I have a nice, comfortable, stable base while I'm doing the procedure. But in terms of patient preparation, we have the patient on an arm board here, and then we just connect up the Nautilus ECG to his chest, and I'll talk to you about that in a moment. All right, so what I'm going to do first of all, so just put a little sticky dots on your chest. So we're just connecting up the Nautilus to the patient now. Really important, I find that the ECG dots are fresh. They can make a good contact with the patient. So we have the three patient leads connected to the patient. We have the yellow lead on the left shoulder, and you'll see I put that right over on the left shoulder. We take the green lead, which goes down on the left hip or left pelvis or the lower part of the abdomen, and the black lead on the right lower part of the abdomen, stroke hip. It's really important that these dots are as far apart as possible. It gives you the best ECG trace, surface ECG trace that you can get. So I've found over the years that if we put these dots as far apart like this as possible, you end up with the best trace you can, that's possible. You haven't got a pacemaker in, have you, sir?
No.
No. Are you on the beta blocker, like a Tenolol or anything like that?
Nothing like that, no.
Okay.
I've got two stents.
Have you?
Two stents.
What tablets do you take, sir?
A cholesterol tablet.
Yeah, that's fine.
I take a Bisoprolol.
Bisoprolol. Bisoprolol.
Yeah.
And,
yeah. And dissoluble aspirin.
Yeah, that's fine. But you take a drug called Bisoprolol, do you?
Yeah,
that's how you say it.
Yeah,
that's fine. Okay, well, let's talk about that then. Yep. Okay, so I've connected the ECG to the patient, the surface ECG, the yellow, the green, and the black lead, and we have a nice surface ECG trace. Now, what you notice here is actually, interestingly, the QRS complex is inverted from a traditional view of it being positive. It's really not a problem at all in this situation, because what we're interested in is the P wave, and we can see very clearly that the patient has good P waves before each QRS complex on the surface ECG, and that's all we're worried about. You may also notice in this patient that the actual ECG is quite slow. Patient's relatively bradycardic, but that's because the patient is taking medication to slow the heart rate. Good. Okay. All right.
Yep. Fine.
So what I'm going to do now is just put a tight band around the top of your arm. Okay. So I'm just setting up the ultrasound before we scrub up. Make sure everything's sorted out so I don't have to touch anything on this particular ultrasound machine. I normally start with a default depth of 2.7 centimeters. We change the preset to focus on a resolution orientated view. And I like the screen to be slightly brighter than average, so I turn the gain up a little bit as well. Essentially, do this procedure single-handed. The other thing I'll do with the Nautilus is make sure that the mouse is hovering over the freeze button. So because during the procedure I want to freeze the image, and I can do that using a piece of gauze over the keypad so I don't desterilize myself, but I need to make sure that the mouse is over the freeze button before I start. Okay,
cool.
Tight band again.
Okay,
so first of all, I'm just gonna prepare the skin with some skin prep. It's very cold on your arm. All right, it's quite normal. Okay, can you lift your arm up off the table for me? That's lovely. Can you just hold it up there just for a moment, okay? I'll just put a ground sheet underneath. That's lovely. Okay, now back down again where it was before. That's perfect. Are you okay there? Comfortable?
Yeah. Good.
I'm now going to just isolate the area. You may find it just goes over your face. It's fine if you want to look the other way. That's absolutely fine. You won't come to any harm. Okay. So we've isolated the area very nicely. Now, as another little tip, a single-handed operator to sort the ultrasound probe out. A little tip, what I've learned, if you put your hand up inside your ultrasound probe cover, put a little bit of gel on your fingers inside the cover. This is all sterile still, obviously. A little bit of gel on the patient. And then making sure that you, before you start, your probe is easily accessible for you. I can reach up, grab the probe inside the glove, inside the sleeve, and then very carefully just ease down the probe cover over the wire to ensure we have a nice sterile probe cover without any help or assistance. Put an elastic band on to keep it nice and secure. Okay, so we're going to have a little look at your arm now, sir. You all right there?
On point.
Yeah, right, yeah, good. Excellent. So we're just assessing the anatomy of the upper arm here. Again, very classical textbook appearance. If I just talk you through, we've got the skin at the top, obviously the biceps muscle here, and then a neurovascular bundle tucked in under the nook of the biceps muscle, the humerus underneath. We've got the artery and a couple of veins, easily compressible, whereas the artery is pulsatile. There's a brachial veins. We're looking over here at a basilic vein, very nice basilic vein. This would be usually my first choice of vein for pick placement. In fact, this is a beautiful, nice, clear vein where we assess the vein up and down his arm. You can see lovely and smooth. There's a suggestion that there might be a nerve on the side here, but I'm coming in from the top, so hopefully we won't have any problems with that nerve just on the side there. Excellent. I can also just make a note of the depth. It's quite superficial, this vein. This is 5 millimeters on my scale and 1 centimeter, so this vein is less than 5 millimeters underneath the skin. So we do need to be a little bit careful when we're using the needle and the local anesthetic, because it's quite superficial. Just going to finally find an appropriate site for the pick insertion. I think just here would be nice. So I'm just placing the vein in the center of the screen from left to right, not over here or over here, but just down the center of the screen. And then my local anesthetic will go right under the center of the probe. So a very sharp scratch coming up, sir. And we're just going to put some local anesthesia in there just to numb the skin. Are you all right?
Yeah, fine.
Stings a bit just for a moment, okay? And then it will go numb. So we'll just give that local anesthetic a moment to work. That's fine. Again, just a slight tip and trick. Over the last few years, we've moved away from just using a needle to locate the vein because moved over to a cannula. So this is a long 20 gauge cannula. The reason being is what we like to do is place the cannula under direct vision into the vein, so I know I've got secure access to the vein for when I need to pass the guide wire. I don't have to worry about the needle moving or the patient moving. So we're going to use a direct vision technique using the ultrasound. I use an out of plane crossbeam technique. So we're just going to locate the vein again, make sure we're nice and comfortable with where it is. Some distortion of the sonoanatomy because of my bleb of local anesthesia. So bevel up on the the needle on the cannula so we can see it more clearly with the ultrasound, and we're just going to go in a little bit of pushing and shoving now, sir. So I'm going to go quite shallow with my angle of attack with the needle rather than steep, because this vein is very superficial, so I don't want to overshoot by going in too far. I'm just trying to pick up the tip of my needle now. I can just start to see it coming down slightly to the right of the vein. I'm going to change my angle so that there we are. You can see the tip of the needle just pressing on the top of the vein. I want to come in directly on the top of the vein here. I can see the vein tenting now, and you can just start to see the tip of the cannula entering the vein. There we are. Now the tip, as I advance, is in the center of the lumen of the vein. Now we use a direct vision technique. This is the way we do ultrasound guided cannulation, as well as when we're accessing the vein for PICC lines. So what I'm going to do now is move my probe away and towards me so I can see locate the very tip of my cannula. There's no white dot here, and there's a white dot here. So this is the tip of my cannula, which I'm going to maneuver to keep down the very center of the vein. Obviously this is quite superficial, so my cannula is very flat. We're just going to advance that up the vein a good distance, like so. And once I know I'm nicely into the vein with the cannula, we simply slide the cannula off into the vein. And now I'm comfortable that even if we move or the patient moves, I've got nice secure venous access ready for my guide wire placement. So what I'm going to do now, this is a safety cannula, so I'm just going to withdraw the needle out of the cannula and thread my wire up. And I'm fairly confident that the wire is going to go straight in. Since I've been using this cannula technique, I've not had any problems placing the guide wire, because I know it's going in the vein. The cannula's already in the vein, and you can see we've got very free movement of my wire, which we always check just to make sure that we've not got any problems. Good. So now we're going to take the cannula out, and we're going to put the microintroducer in. I'm going to press on the patient's arm here, on the vein, so that we don't have too much spillage while I'm doing this. Again, I'm pressing with my left hand. I'm sort of resting that on my finger so that I don't have to let go. So there's less hematoma developing. We just thread that onto the wire, like so. Now at this point, again, I'm making sure I've got some wire either, I can get to the wire either at this end of the introducer or this end, so that I don't lose the wire inside the patient. So once we've threaded it down onto the patient. Now again, another tip and trick over the years, I've now moved away from doing a dermatotomy. I don't cut the skin unless I absolutely have to. And what we find normally is that if you just go in and out with the introducer through the skin, eventually it will just pop through the skin. Sometimes if you twist the introducer, it will go through a little bit more smoothly. And just dilate that skin. The gauze to hold the skin steady. Just a matter of patience, really. So we just use the microintroducer just to create a passage through the skin, and then it will pop through eventually through the skin and into the vein using a firm forward movement. And that way we haven't created any bleeding or excess trauma to the skin. Again, we just check our guide wire moves freely inside the arm, which it does, absolutely fine. All right,
yeah,
that's step two done, well done. So now we're going to get to the point of using the Nautilus and threading our PICC line into the patient. So we're going to take our saline connector, which we've already pre-prepared with the PICC line on the side. So I can pick up the end of the Nautilus connector with a piece of gauze so that I don't have to de-sterilize myself, and then just reach in and press it together on the red lead and just dump the lot away out of my sterile field. So now we're ready to thread the PICC line in. So just roll your arm out slightly for me. So that's lovely. Again, the technique I've developed is to have my PICC line ready. I press with my fingers here to try and prevent the patient bleeding too much, and we take the guide wire and the dilator out at the same time, and then we can go straight in with the PICC line into the vein. So we've placed the PICC line in the vein to start with, only 10 or 15 centimeters, and already we can see on the ECG on the Nautilus there's no change yet. That's because almost always we haven't generated a good solid column of saline from the connector to the tip of the line. So what I'm going to do now is we're just going to flush the PICC line just to double check that we've got a good connection, which we have. Again, what you often see is that the yellow intracavity ECG trace will wander around all over the place. That's because it's very movement sensitive. You can see if I've just moved this around, it pretty much destroys the ECG trace. We're not getting any sort of really comprehensive ECG trace there, and that's probably because we're not in far enough. So I'm going to release the tourniquet and thread the line in a little bit further towards the central circulation. If you could just look to the left for me, sir. and tuck your chin right down on your shoulder. Again, get this the patient to look over. It just tries to help the line, prevent the line from going up the internal jugular. We just gradually thread in and see where we are. Have a look at the ECG. So now we're in this in the central, we're getting towards the central system. You can see the ECG starts to appear and actually doesn't look very much different from the surface ECG. I'm just going to freeze that so I can talk to you about that a little bit more. If I just freeze that, you'll see that it's got a P wave on there and a QRS, which doesn't look that different from the surface ECG. So it would suggest that we've got good, the system is working well, we're getting a good ECG signal, but that we're not anywhere near the myocardium at this point, near the heart. So I'm just threading it in. Again, I'm getting a little bit of resistance there, some bouncy resistance. Again, that's not unusual. I'm just gonna see if we can get around that point. This, there we are, it's just popped through. So again, that could potentially have just flicked up and gone the wrong way, or it might be going down towards the heart. So at this point, this is when the Nautilus really comes into its own, because I can now use the Nautilus to confirm for myself that the line is going the correct direction towards the heart. If we just advance that a little bit more, like so, and then just leave it to rest, we'll see what we come up with. Okay, there we go, perfect. So if I just freeze that, what you'll see here is the QRS complex in line with the other QRS complex on the ECG. But before that, instead of having a small P wave like we saw earlier, we now have this very large P wave, which indicates to me that the tip of the PIC line is heading down towards the right atrium, if not at or near the right atrium. So what we want to do now, we know that the line has gone in the correct direction. We're now going to fine tune the positioning of the line to reassure ourselves that the tip is exactly where we want it to be. Now, it's important to note, I'm going to talk through the ECG changes. Where you want the tip of your line to be is entirely up to you as a clinician to decide. So if you want to leave it at the cavoatrial junction, you want to leave it just poking into the right atrium, or you want to leave it above the cavoatrial junction, we can use the ECG system to allow us to do exactly what it is you want to do with the tip of your line. So at the moment, we have a large P wave here, and it's worth noting that in every patient, the size of the P wave, the changes in the size of the P wave will vary from patient to patient. In this particular gentleman, there's a very large P wave, even bigger than the QRS complex, which is not unusual. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to thread the line in a little bit further. I know I'm going in the right direction, so I'm going to thread the line in a little bit further, leave it alone, and see what kind of trace we get now. Okay, so what I'm looking at now, again, very easy to follow. I'm just going to freeze that so I can talk to you about it. What you're seeing here on the P wave here in the live feed, but also on the freeze, is that the P wave is now biphasic. There's a large negative deflection as well as a positive deflection. And this suggests that the tip of the PIC line is now pretty much in the right atrium. The other thing you'll notice, just as a tip and a trick, is that the baseline of this intracavity ECG does tend to wander sometimes. I mean, what we find is if you just leave it alone and let it settle, it will usually always appear back into view on the screen. It's not worth messing about trying to get it to come into view using the slider bars on the side, because it invariably will settle down. But you can see very clearly here that we've got a maximum, a big P, but also a big negative deflection. So in terms of the tip position, the tip is now in the right atrium. For me, my personal preference is to leave the line at the tip of it just above the right atrium without any negative deflection. So what we're going to do now is just have a look at the changes in the P wave amplitude, because when we talk about maximum P, it's often interesting just to see what we mean by that. So I'm going to pull the line back a couple of centimeters and see what we have now. So here we go again, absolutely classical as we've pulled it back. I'll just freeze that again. You can see we have a large P wave with a very small, tiny negative deflection. Now that negative deflection, the biphasic is slightly negative, but really nothing like we saw on the previous view. But also what you'll notice is that the amplitude of the negative deflection is changing. So there's a, not such a big one there, a little bit bigger here and a bit smaller there. That's quite normal. That's because as the patient breathes in and out, the whole pericardium will move up and down, and therefore the tip will move in relation to the right atrium. So I can pull it back a little bit more again, because we're just going to demonstrate how useful the tool is to allow us to place the line exactly where you want it to be placed. So if we look again here, what we have is a maximal P, but with no negative deflections, which suggests that the line is now at the cavoatrial junction, literally just above the right atrium. There's a suggestion of a tiny bit of negative for deflection there on that complex. But really what we're looking at here is a large P wave, but without any negative deflection. So my personal preference is this is the location that we would leave the line. I can pull it back a little bit more just to demonstrate to you the P wave amplitude changes. Again, if we pull it back, actually, interestingly, it's even bigger now, which would suggest that we are back a bit more. I can come back a bit more again. And there you can see that the P wave amplitude has completely disappeared. There's a small blip there, but there isn't really much to write home about. Again, little tip and trip. You can tip and trick. You can see right now that the line has gone completely flatline. Again, nothing to worry about. It's not unusual. It's probably just because we've lost our column of saline. So what I'm going to do is reconnect my syringe and just give it a little squirt, and just to regenerate that continuous column of saline. It's one of the commonest reasons why people find that their ECG trace is not as ideal as they would like, is because that column of saline is not as perfect as it could be. So we can see on here, we've got the small P waves again. I'm going to go in with my line, looking for that maximum P without any negative deflection. If you want to go just to the cavoatrial junction or just into the top of the right atrium, bearing in mind the patient's lying down, then that's absolutely fine. So there we are, I'm very happy with that. We've got a large P wave without any negative deflection, so I'm absolutely fine with that. I'm just going to freeze that and we can move on. There we go. Great. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to check where the pick length is for this particular position. So I'm just counting off the 59, 58, 76, 55, 54, 53, 52, 51, 50. How does that look? That's 50 at the skin. I'm just going to check. Yeah, I'm very happy with that. We've got a nice big P wave, same as that. So when we finished with this line positioning, we want the line to be the 50 mark of centimetres at the skin. Okay, good. That's that bit done. So what we can do now is we introduce the stiffening wire out of the PICC line. I'm just going to clip this across for now just to stop it bleeding back. I've pulled the line a little bit out, but that's absolutely fine because I know where I want to end up at the end. We're just going to cut that off, aren't we? So if we look at 50 marks, so that's 50 there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I normally leave about 5 centimetres on the outside. So 51, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I'm just going to make a neat cut across here with a scalpel blade. So, and we want our connector. Slide that over the line. Now we need to make sure that the PICC line, the end of the PICC line, is fed right over the bevel of the connector right up to the hub, which is done. There we are. Tighten that back up. Like so. Lovely. Very happy with that. So we're just going to pop that back in a little bit. OK, can take the clip off now. And we can see blood coming back, which is another confirmatory sign that we're in the right place. Well, we know we're in the right place, 100% certainty. Take my bionectar off the saline adapter. We can see that it's absolutely fine. So we're just going to flush that, and as we're flushing, we put the clip across to lock it. There we go. So what we want to do now is take the microinducer out, the split peelable microinducer. I know that I want to be 50 at the skin, which is this mark here. So I'm just going to pop that in a little bit further than we want, so that when we take the microinducer out, we don't run any risk of the line being pulled out any further than we want. Like so. And then final position, we're just going to check on the, that's 50 at the skin, which is exactly where we want it to be. Excellent. Good, so I'm just going to press on that again, just to keep that nice and firm. All done, sir, you've been fantastic. Well done, thank you. Going to clean up, just a bit of clean up and then we're all done. Is that all right?
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, you could look over that way now if you want to. Yeah. This securement fixation device, like so, squeeze it together in a nice firm grip. There we are. I'll just find a nice position on your arm for it there. You okay?
Yeah. Yep.
Lovely job. Okay, I'm just going to make one little final clear up. It's also my personal practice, just to put a little Steri-Strip on that just for the first day or so, just to secure that. And also put a little bit of gauze underneath. Change this in 24 or 48 hours time, just for a standard clear occlusive dressing. So normally you just have this dressing on there. Okay. Lovely. There we go. All done, sir. All right. That's all yours. There we go. All right, you can sit yourself up now. That's excellent.